Let me just shut the game down there. There we go. Welcome to another official Dovetail stream, folks. So today we're going to have a look at some new content that's been released for the American audience over the last couple of weeks, including yesterday. We're going to start off with the New Haven FL9 for the New York New Haven route, which has the it's an unusual loco. It looks a little bit perhaps like an F7 to the uninitiated. But in fact, it's actually quite a different machine. It's quite a bit longer. It's got a twin axle on the front and a triple axle on the back. It's actually a BA1A. So it's got two powered axles on the front and two powered axles on the back with a load bearer in the middle. It's also dual power. So it's capable of diesel, which is what it uses the majority of the time. And then when it's in Grand Central Terminal and one or two other places, it switches to third rail power, which it can use for short periods of time. Obviously, with the long areas that it's underground under Grand Central Terminal, you don't want to be having all those diesel fumes there. So that's why they're now they've got the third rail. Very similar to if you've got the P32 ACDM, or DM stands for dual mode and means the same thing. It can be third rail or diesel, which is pretty much the same as this. In fact, I think the P32 ACDM was the successor for this local, particularly in this particular area. So it's run. It runs the sort of commuter services with the Shoreliner coaches, and you can drive either from the FL9 or you can drive from the cab car at the other end. Right. Now, without further ado, I've now got to start the game up again because I shut it down rather than just muting it. That was silly. So, while I'm waiting for the game to start, let us just have another. Well, so, yes, we're going to be doing the FL9, as I said, on the New York-New Haven route. Here we go. The game is just starting up. And so tonight we're going to be looking at the FL9 first. We're then going to look at the F40PHL-2 Miami Commuter Rail train. And then we're going to be having a look at the Seaboard U36B U-boat. So the way we're going to look at them is a little bit of a description, like I've just done for the FL9. And then we're going to play a quick scenario. So in this case, we're going to start off with the FL9 on New York to New Haven in a scenario written by Gary Dozel from El Fava's workshop. You can get the full scenario on Steam. The game will show up in a minute. How, folks? Howdy. Yes, Track IR supported in the latest version of Train Simulator. If you've got Track IR, make sure you've updated your game. There we go. It's updated. Yes, make sure you've updated Track IR and download the latest game updates for it. And it should show up as Dovetail Train Simulator 2015. And once it's done that, it just works. You don't have to do anything else. It's very easy to use. So to this particular scenario, as I said, was from Alfaba's workshop. You can download it from Steam Workshop. And this is just the first little bit of it. So it's called the Waterbury Shuttle. thanks, Joe. So it's the first part of the Waterbury Shuttle. New Haven Line dispatcher to MNECR train 1935. The mainline traffic has cleared, and subject to signal indication, you may enter track 3 at Devon Junction and proceed southbound to Bridgeport. Dispatcher out. So here she is, as I said before, two axles and three axles. So, but not a BOCO, because only two of them are actually powered. It's A1A at the back. Right, so let's get in the cab. So Track IR moving us around the, so we can see what's going on. Now let's get moving and then we can talk about some other stuff. Right, so one of the things I've heard about Track IR, some people saying it's great for flights, because of course you can look around and do your approaches and so forth. But trains, you don't really need that, so why do you need this? Well, there's a good reason. Yeah, normally view, I can't see my signals, but up here, I can, and I can see very easily that this signal has just changed to a clear aspect. So we're just going a bit too fast here. Oh no, back up. So yeah, so you can see every movement. Now you can tune how responsive Track IR is, so if you find it's too jittery or not moving enough, You can tune that in the track IR software. Get some lights on. Cab lights. So when you get to where you need to change power sources, this is your lever that you want to use. So we're in mode 1 at the moment, and you need to flick it to mode 2, which will cut off the diesel engine and switch you to third rail power. So we're just coming out of the 30 at the moment, it says, hoping we get to 30 before we break it. There we go. I knew it was going to hit faster in a minute. So this is the first half of the Waterbury Shuttle scenario. And the full scenario involves you going two directions. So you head down the main line in this direction to Bridgeport, and then you do a crossover manoeuvre to get to the other side, and then head using the cab car back to where you came from. So it's quite a nice short out and back run with some AI traffic in the way, which actually makes the signalling a little bit interesting, because you've got to keep watching what you're doing and reacting to the signal changes. So that's the scenario. We're just going to go to Bridgeport, and then the scenario will finish. If you download the Waterbury Shuttle, then you can play the rest of it. So we're coming up to Stratford, track 3. Just a minute. Light off, we don't need that. Let's cut the power so we can begin our approach. Sounds like I'm flying a plane again, doesn't it? Beginning an approach. Yes, I shall blow the horn as we leave Stratford. Got a Kawasaki M8 over there, just in the distance. Right, that gets us stopped here, and open the doors. So with the track IR, you can also go into head-out mode, and you can look around in head-out. And as you can see, I'm getting a full 180 degrees of movement without actually moving my head 180 degrees. You can still very much see what's going on the screen. Okay, conduct doors closed. Highball, our next station stop to disembark passengers at Bridgeport. We're on track 3. Standard procedure, bell as we leave the station. So while we're out of the cab, let's just have a quick look at the loco. So you've got multiple brightnesses of lights, so I've got 3 different brightnesses to pick from. The Kawasaki M8 coming across there. This is the old and the new, with a FL9 and an M8 crossing. That's So you can see also as I move up and down the track IR is following my movements, and as I move left it's following my movements as well. Now obviously the track IR camera has to still see me. You can even if you want to get creative, you can tilt your head. So our next station stop is in Bridgeport, just under 3 miles away, and that'll be where we'll be concluding this particular scenario. As you can see again, I've got full access to the whole 180 degrees in either direction. We've got a 60 limit coming up and then a 45 limit. That's probably going to mean we're going to get some signalling involved. So I'll keep an eye on the signalling in the top corner. Let's just have a bit more horn, shall we? There we go. Right. Right, so a rather hurriedly modified version of this scenario doesn't seem to have worked very well. So I think that's probably where this is going to have to end. But oh dear. So I missed the red light there. That wasn't very good, was it? What we'll do is we'll restart this scenario and we'll have a quick look at the cab car. Sorry about that, everybody. So, we'll just rerun that scenario, and, oh no, epic fail, yeah, okay, I'll take that, guys, I'll take that. That was not well done, but never mind. You got to see the FL9, and what we'll do is we'll just have a quick look at the cab car. No, I can't blame that one on spending too much time on the outside, I'm afraid. So let's go and have a look at the cab car while we're here. It was requested we have a look, so this is the cab car. This is your in-cab signalling in the cab car. So at the moment it's showing a restrictive aspect. That'll be medium, limited, and there you go. So medium, it actually points and tells you what the speed limit is as well for each one. And then that shows you your current speed. So you've got lots of controls up here. This is your control for power. This one up here, so you've got diesel there and electric there. So if you happen to be driving the in cab car forward, that's what you use to switch the power mode. Let's have a quick look on the outside. Right, so that is the so we've just had a couple of questions. Yes, I am using track IR. So I've had a couple of questions. I am using the cab car. I'm using the track IR, and so this is sort of the kind of movements you get with the track IR. So that's pretty much the overview of the FL9. And those of you who are on the chat, it's competition time, I think. So if you have a look at the chat, you will be finding out more about what's happening on the competition. Meanwhile, I'm going to just pop the page back to the a blanking page while we do the competition. So the first question is going to be read out on the chat. So please make sure you're paying attention to the chat, not listening to the stream for the question. It's on the chat. So the first person to answer the question is going to receive a key for the FL9. Okay, folks, thanks for participating in the competition. So in this particular round, NEC Male TC wins the Steam key for a copy of the FL9. Congratulations. So, moving on, it is time for the F40PHL-2, which is the Miami Commuter Rail service. So let's have a quick look at the train. So it's a diesel electric and high speed. It runs with the Bombardier Byliner coaches up and down the Miami to West Palm Beach line. Serving the busy commuter services. So for those of you who've got the Miami to West Palm Beach route, and that's all of you, of course, isn't it? They will enjoy the fact that they'll now be able to really richen up the, enliven your routes with lots of extra services in and amongst the Amtrak services and the Dash 8 services that you're already running on the line. So this will really add a tremendous amount of extra traffic to what you're doing with the Miami to West Palm Beach route. So let's, without further ado, let's get on and drive it and take a look at it. Hello again. Hopefully this time we will not be running any red lights. So in this particular scenario, we're going to be doing a short run from Fort Lauderdale with a stop at Fort Lauderdale Airport, and then we're going to make a final stop at Sheridan. Apologies for the error on the little slide there. It said it was a power type electric. It's not. It's a diesel electric, of course. Right, so let's open the doors and just have a quick look around the cab of this F40PHL-2. So we've got cab lights, as always. I was speaking to someone the other day who didn't know how to turn the lights on using the button. It's this thing here. Yeah, that's where you turn the cab lights on if you want to click on them in the cab. It's got a fairly standard control panel for American locomotives. So, it's time to go. The passengers are finished. Let's get moving, turn some headlights on, and get out of here. Now, there is a bell going. It's just very quiet from the outside, from the inside. So let's have a listen outside. Let the train go past and have a look at the consist that runs along behind. If it's on your keyboard, the button is the L key. That's the one that you want. Right, so let's get a little bit of speed up and get on to our next destination, which is Fort Lauderdale Airport. Instrument lights. So I'll have a look in the cab car once we get to our destination. Miami's one of my favorite. Well, Florida is certainly one of my favorite places. Must admit, Miami's an interesting place. It's like a really big, bustling city. Whoever, but Miami's lovely though. We're nearly in the 60s, close enough. So we've got the Silver Meteor going past us there, an Amtrak service, which runs long distance across the country. Its southern end is at Miami. The other end of the route. Further down, we're actually heading in the direction of Miami. We're going south at the moment. Well, Mr. Tropics is from Tampa Bay. I used to have relatives in Port Charlotte, just down the road, well, a little bit, about an hour and a half down the road, but down the road. Right, let's cut some power down, we've just reached the speed limit. Going under some highways here. Yeah, a little bit of speeding. Life wouldn't be complete without a little bit of speeding. Well, there's our first airliner, so we must be getting close to the airport, and there it is on the HUD, 1.5 miles away. So we've got another Miami commuter rail train heading in the other direction. So when you're setting up your own consists of these, remember that the it's always locos to the south, cab cars to the north. There's the airport over there. Right, let's get sorted to stop here. Nice marina over there on the right. So we're just coming into Fort Lauderdale with this commuter rail train. Brakes. I think that was actually a quiet zone. Probably shouldn't have been blowing the horn. Never mind. Wake the neighbours up. Right. Coming into Fort Lauderdale. So while we're at this station, let's just have a quick look at the cab car. So this is the cab car. Okay, we've got permission to proceed, so let's go. Next stop, Sheridan, 2 miles. Another commuter train coming in the other direction by the looks of it. Yep, here she comes. The other nice thing with tracker, I can sort of look down at the whistle boards and see whether there's anything you need to be worrying about or dealing with. Let's get it moving, shall we? Hear it really working. Sheridan's coming up, a bit over a mile. Ready for our descent into Sheridan. So the Miami to West Palm Beach route comes with the Silver Meteor and the Dash 8 in CSX livery, which is just about to go past us, along with an appropriate selection of freight. Coming into Sheridan now. Decelerated probably a bit too harshly there. Never mind. Sheridan Street. So all of those stations that you've been flying past in the Silver Meteor or on the Dash 8 with the F40PHL-2, you now have the equipment to service those stations. And hopefully what this should give you is a whole new kind of gameplay from this particular route and open up some more, a bit more variety for you. Just have another quick look round on the outside. Turn the bell off now. And that's the end of this particular scenario, and that means it's competition time, folks. So I'm going to switch it back to the blanking plate, and I'm going to let the team take over and get the next question out. Don't forget, the question is going to be asked in the chat window. Get ready with your expert knowledge. These are not easy questions. Congratulations to John Trainhead. You have won the key to the F40PHL-2. Congratulations. So, with that, let's move on and have a look at the next subject for the evening, which is the Seaboard U36B U-boat. So let's just switch over. So the General Electric U36B diesel-electric locomotive. It comes in the pack in both Seaboard Coastline, which is the black livery, and the Seaboard Systems livery. There's a selection of wagons, and there's also a rather nice caboose at the back. So hang on, it says here, doesn't it? Yeah, freight wagons include the bay-covered hoppers and a caboose. There we go. So that will allow you to run some era-appropriate trains. Again, this is for the Miami to West Palm Beach route. And we're going to be looking at this one with another scenario, which has actually just been uploaded to Steam Workshop, and is called Seaboard Southbound. And again, it's another one from Gary Dolezal, Elphaba's Workshop. So you can download that one yourself and have a play. So I'm going to kick that one off, and let's have a play with this scenario. This one's a little bit longer. Hi again. So just wait for this one to load. So this is a primarily freight train, although... There we go. Miami Subdivision Dispatcher to SEL Extra 1837 South. The northbound stone train, lead unit SEL 1819, is coming over New River now and should be clear of you in a few minutes. Dispatcher out. So while that's coming, we can go and have a look around and a play and see what's going on. We've got a couple of minutes before anything actually will happen on the route. So this is the Seaboard Coastline livery. Fortunately, this particular scenario is meant to be a single era, so it doesn't include the other livery. We'll see if we can have a look at that one in a minute. So as you can see, it's got the gyro lights on the front there, so let's turn some lights on. Again, you've got main beams, and you've got different brightnesses that you can switch on. Let's get in the cab and have a look around. So there's a number of new things in this loco that we've not done before. So you've got individual control over all of the blinds. You've got individual manual control over wipers. And they're not, you literally are controlling them. You can also manually control the switches for them, so you can switch just one wiper on automatic. Or up here we can turn that one off and turn that one on and just have that one going. So you've got full control. Now if you're just using the HUD, then as you would expect, clicking the wipers on will turn everything on. So you've still got full control. That one's not moving for intentional, that one is broken. But you can open the door. So let's step out onto the front. Get back in the cab. Shut the door. We've also got windows that open. Let's get some windows open, let some air into this cab. It's lovely and hot in this Miami summer day. Step light switch and the task light switch. Now we've got the gyro light going. You can't really see too much, but if you look carefully, you can just about see the light swinging around there. Right, following the passage of the northbound stone train, the dispatcher will line the junction for you at approximately 16:04:15. You may need to request permission for the dwarf signal after that time. So we've got we can get the gyro light off. The gyro light basically functions similarly to flashing ditch lights, so you use them at crossings. Wait another 14 seconds and then we'll get the line to go. I don't think we really need the wipers on, do we? Let's turn the wipers off. Right, we've got the green light, so let's go. It's living. Let's go and have a look at these wagons while we start accelerating. So these are the hoppers that come in the pack. We fly down the end of the train, so we've got some tank cars part of the pack. Not of this particular pack, it's just the hoppers. These are the only wagons that come in this particular pack. And at the back of the train, we have the caboose. And there is, of course, the obligatory passenger view, or the guard's view, for the want of a better word. Right, let's get back in the cab. So we're up to the speed limit now. We've got white lights on the front. We're not using these ones are the class lights. The classification lights are used for different purposes that indicate if you've got multi-part trains, essentially. So off is the normal if you are a full service. So we should be hitting the 30 limit in a minute. We've got 30, so we can throttle up. We've got a high ball, so we're clear to proceed. Let's go and have a look outside and hear this thing go past, shall we? Coming up to the 30 now. Yacht over there. There's a lot of really great detail on this route. I think it's through running different kinds of services on it. It's amazing. Each time you run the route with a different kind of service, you'll pick out different bits of detail on the route as you go. Small amount of brake on here. So our next waypoint is Anglers Avenue in 1.1 miles. There's Anglers Avenue, we're just down there. So let's have a quick look at the task list and see what we've got coming up here. So we've got a bunch of rerouting, and then we're heading to Hylia Yard. Past some more hoppers. So after we get past Anglers Avenue, we're going to get the opportunity to open it up a little bit. So one other thing is, while we're in the we're wandering around here, up here is a brake gauge. So I'm in the caboose at the moment, and you can see the brake gauge. Now as I apply the brakes, so you can see that we've actually got the brake gauge in the caboose actually working. So in the caboose, you can see what the brake gauge is doing. So we're almost into the 60. Head of the train's passing through. Oh, we're actually coming past the same piece of track we were in before, if you hadn't noticed. So there's that marina we passed earlier on. So as I think I mentioned previously, you've got three positions. So you've got the driver's view, you've got the conductor's view, and then we can shouldn't really do this while we're moving, but since it's a simulator, we'll do it. We can get out onto the front, so let's get back in, and before anyone notices and we get in trouble. So you've got the three viewpoints to move around. There we go, we're about to get the 60. There we go. Time to wind up that engine. Shoot down the track a little bit as she's accelerating, and want to try and get it going a bit of a speed as we go past. Oh, there's a aircraft taking off from the airport. Got to get my real 14L correct-ish. Didn't quite have the timing done correctly. Thank you. So I'm just setting up a poll to see what you thought the best, your favourite loco from what we've covered tonight is. There we go, I've done it now. So, what loco was your favourite from the stream this evening? So if you type exclamation mark vote, it will tell you what the details are. Exclamation mark vote space FL9, if we want to vote for the FL9. Exclamation mark vote U36B, if you want to vote for that one. Or exclamation mark vote F40PHL-2, if you want to vote for that one. Which one is your favourite from what you've seen today? That's a silent zone, so let's just use the bell. Now, what I've just done there is I've shut the window, so I don't know if you've noticed the audio has changed subtly. So far the FL9 is out in front. Oh, I didn't even see that 45 speed limit coming up. Spending too much time looking at poles. Let's get this train slowed down. Of course, a train like this isn't going to slow down quickly. Another U36 over here. So we're doing 45 in a 45. It's a good place to be. Yeah, someone asked for a poll. I did a poll and stopped looking at what I was doing. Right, we're about to get the 60 again in a bit under 3/4 of a mile. The sign facing the other direction, so I don't need to do anything about that. Just got all the usual bell, sander, same controls you would normally expect. The control deck. Stand is fairly similar to where most other US locos you'll have driven. It's another whistle board that says it's in a quiet zone, so we need to not use the rule 14L. So rule 14L is where why I'm blowing the horn lots on crossings. It says you have to blow a long, a short, and then a long, with the last long ending as the front rear axle crosses on here. So we're now coming into the 60 as soon as the rest of the train has caught up. So don't forget the poll. If you haven't already voted, please cast your vote. We want to hear what your favourite train is from the three we've covered this evening. The FL9 on New York New Haven. My brain isn't working. The F40PHL-2, it's written in the bottom right of the screen. The F40PHL-2 on Miami West Palm Beach. And this one, the Seaboard U36B U-boat on the Miami to West Palm Beach line. So, if you haven't voted, cast your vote. Yes, Sander. Right, we're in the 60. Time to crank her up. So Sparky's just commented about there being a horn code, and yes, FRA regulations, Rule 14, covers a wide variety of horn types, horn sequences, of which 14L is the one for a grade crossing, and there are other ones such as blowing the horns twice before you start moving, to let anyone nearby know that you're moving, and many others. I mean, you can tell from the fact that it's Rule 14L that there are quite a few that came before it. So yes, if you look up FRA Rule 14, then you should be able to get all the details and improve the authenticity of your simulating. The game doesn't mandate or even check that you do that, but it's a nice touch. So the poll isn't just for your favourite train. Is your favourite train one of these three? Your favourite train, the poll is for which of these three do you like the most? If you were to order these three, which is the one you put at the top? K is your step light key. So Golden Glades, Main One North is our next waypoint we're just coming up to now. approaching the speed limit, so I'm going to dial back the notches, bring the engine back under control. So yeah, just a quick recap of some of the features on here. You've got individual direct control over the wipers, and they will actually wipe the screen. You've got the buttons to get them going automatically. We've got this one over here, which gets the wiper going on the back here. Oh, it's just a little bit too far back to look at comfortably for any length of time. So L gets you a cab light. Is that what I look like from the outside, is it? Interesting. Let's get back into me then. Another U-boat coming in the other direction. Oops, missed a whistleboard. That lovely caboose on the back. Oh, I missed another 45. Ah! While we're slowing down, let's have a look at the caboose at the back. We'll be back under the 45 in a minute. Right, we're back under the 45. Let's have a quick look ahead, see what that signal's saying. That signal looks like it's giving us an approach, so I'm going to continue slowing down. So, let's look at the plan here. Pilot Yard Gate North is where we're heading next. Where is that? There it is, over there, 1.8 miles. This is Opa-locka. So let's go back in the cab. We just had a pop-up. I'll have you lined over to cross over to track 2 and then into Hylia Yard lead gate north. The yardmaster will contact you for instructions on yarding your train. Dispatcher out. Right, we've got a minute. Let's get back in this caboose and have a look around. So the caboose is facing the other way, so I've got to look funny to be able to see out the back. Seats facing in alternate directions, and then of course you can look down here where you've got the seats. So when you pick, if you pick up a track IR, one of the things you can make a choice of, there's two different ways of doing it. One of them is the clip, which is this thing. Pits on a baseball clip. Very simple, low tech. Or they also have a headset clip that clips up here and will... it means you don't have to wear a baseball cap for a start, as long as you've got a headset on. So I've got a couple of yellow lights here, so we need to get slowed down because we're being diverted off the main line now, ready for going into Hylia Yard. Slow down for the 20. Of course, right at the end of the scenario, I'm reminded of that I did actually have a cab backdrop for the U36B, which I totally forgot to use. Never mind, we're using it now. There we go. We're in the yard. We didn't quite get the right speed limit, but. Going via Hylia departure north. Hylia Yardmaster to SCL Extra 1837 South. Bring your train to the south end of Hylia Yard 3 and leave your power attached. Hostler will come over and take the units to the engine terminal. Yardmaster out. So we are stopping at Hylia Yard 3. Let's just have a quick look at the map, find out where we're going. So we're actually under the next speed limit anyway, so that's fine. Back in the cab, watch what we're doing. Got a yellow approach signal. And the HUD has now confirmed that the routing is all set correctly for us. I haven't got any manual junctions to switch, so we just have to make it in. We're already within the speed limit coming up, so I don't have to do anything else. Except we're gently speeding up. ability to reposition yourself left and right is very handy, so you can get a better view on what you particularly want to look at that point. It's useful if there's a signal and you're at an awkward angle, you can move yourself around so that you can see it. If you happen to have parked stop just a little bit too close to it. So we're just pulling into Hylia Yard 3, and that's where this scenario will finish. Guess what happens when this scenario finishes? It's competition time. So just to recap then, in this particular pack, in the U36B, you get the two liveries, the black and the grey, and one for Seaboard Coastline, which is this one, and the other one's the Seaboard System livery. You also get the hopper wagons, which I'm sporting here, and the new caboose on the back. The hopper wagons actually come with two different liveries. There's this one, which is slightly dirtier, and this one, if I can press the right buttons, which is slightly cleaner. We get asked a lot about weathered stuff, so we've included different variations on the weathering. So, bring the train to a stop. Now we're in Hylia Yard. Oh, she sounds like she's struggling to stop. Right, there we go. So, the scenario is now done. So the question has been posted. Well done, the Hylia Hostler will be over soon to take care of the power. Climb down, this run is complete. So, that was the U36B, the Seaboard U36B. And so over the course of today's show, we have looked at the FL9 on the New York-New Haven route. We looked at the F40PHL-2 commuter train on the Miami-West Palm Beach route. And we also took a look at the Seaboard U36B on the Miami-West Palm Beach route. I'll just have a quick look at the poll and see where the poll stands. So at this point, the U36B comes out top at 55.6% of the vote, and the FL9 with 33, and there were a couple of invalid votes that weren't counted. So that's really interesting to hear. So, the Railfan 98 wins the U36B. Congratulations. So I've got one more prize to give away. So keep an eye on the chat window. One more question coming. Just organising the next prize. Apologies for the delay. Last question coming up. So this is all on the chat window. So we're asking the next question. So the question is, which state is the Miami-West Palm Beach route in? And of course there is a flurry of rapid answers. John Trainhead wins again. Congratulations again, John. So the prize for this particular one was is a copy of the route itself, the Miami to West Palm Beach route. So congratulations, John. And that is the end of this Dovetail stream this evening. Thank you very much, everybody, for joining in, and I hope you've enjoyed the look at these three locos and the competitions. If you want to see more or have any comments, then let us know through the usual routes: Facebook, Twitter, Engine Driver. And we'll do our best to take on that feedback. We really do want to hear the feedback, so please do let us know what you think. So we've just looked at the New Haven FL9, the Seaboard U36B, and the Miami Commuter Rail F40PHL-2. You'll find out more details on Steam. They're available now to purchase. And happy railroading! Thanks very much, everyone, for joining in and taking your time to spend with us. And I look forward to the next stream coming soon. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.